Buying a shed today is a lot different than it was 20 years ago, and in this video, I'm going to share my experience of ordering a new shed, getting the site prepared, and take you through the whole process so that you'll know what to expect if you decide to order one and understand some of the problems that could come up. First, you need to decide where you're going to put your shed. Now, you want to try to pick a level spot, and the swing set location was perfect because it was 12 years old, my kids have pretty much outgrown it, so we gave it away, and now we needed to decide on the type of shed to order. Now, I recommend getting the biggest shed you can afford, and pay attention to your town's permit rules, and in mine I can get a 192 square foot shed without requiring any special kind of building permit. And now you need to prepare the site, and that involves leveling it, but more importantly, you're going to want to put gravel underneath your shed. And most companies recommend 6 inches of crushed stone, and you could certainly put this down with just a wheelbarrow, but I was quite a distance from the driveway, so I decided I wanted to rent one of these small Kubotas to make the job a little bit easier. But unfortunately, the state of Massachusetts passed a new law that if you rent any kind of excavator that you sit in, you need a hoisting license. But fortunately, Home Depot had an option for me that would still allow me to lift the materials without sitting in the actual machine. And this is what I rented. It's the Toro Dengo TX427. It rents for $289 a day, which certainly isn't cheap, but this little tank is going to make this job a lot easier, and it even drives kind of like a car. First thing I wanted to do was flatten out the area before I even put down any gravel. Now that involves just dropping down the bucket on the ground and then dragging it back. And this machine might look a little scary, but it's actually one of the easiest ones that I've ever rented. Another tip for using a machine like this so that you get a nice level surface is to learn about what's called a float mode. Now all that means is putting the lever in a certain position that makes that bucket float on top of the dirt. And that kind of puts the bucket in a neutral position, so it uses its own weight to go across the surface and give you a nice level result. Now this area worked out well because it was already clear to begin with, but even if you had grass growing, this thing could strip it right out of there in no time and completely clear the space. Now I'm ready to bring the gravel over to where the shed is going to go. Now to make that a little bit easier, I'm going to go ahead and use my Kubota, but you could just as easily use the Dingo to bring the gravel directly to the site, or you could even dump it into a wheelbarrow and then bring it over to where the shed is going to go. Now the reason I'm doing this is that the bed in the Kubota is about 4 times the size of that bucket, so that's going to really reduce the number of trips I need to take. And of course the better option is if you can get the gravel delivered directly to where the shed is going to go. And unfortunately I couldn't do that because my septic tank and leaching field are in the way, and you don't want to drive a full-size truck over that kind of area. And unfortunately smaller equipment like this is okay to drive on, so this is the method that I'm going to use. I was able to get all the gravel over there in just about an hour, and if you did it by hand, it was definitely going to take a lot longer. I also found it a little bit harder to spread out the gravel with the machine, so I went ahead and just got a rake and tried to level it out as best I can. And most often when you're going to get a shed delivered, they will do a little bit of work when they get there to help you do some final leveling, but you want to make sure that your base is prepared as much as possible so that when you get the shed delivered, things are going to go a lot easier.
Alright.
And finally, you're ready for your shed. Now this thing is 12 by 16, and the company is based in Connecticut. Now if your site allows it, they might be able to bring the truck right in and lower the shed into position. But unfortunately for me, I got a 1200 foot long driveway, and the shed needed to go in the back corner of my yard, and they definitely couldn't drive the truck all the way there. And that's where this piece of equipment comes in, and it's called the Mule. Now this Mule can do something pretty amazing. It's going to pick up that entire shed and move it across my yard anywhere I want to put it. But the Mule only has one engine, and that's what the guy is driving on, so they also include these wheels. Now they're going to put these on the opposite end of the trailer. They'll allow it to coast kind of like a skateboard right across my grass. But the other cool thing is this trailer. It has mechanisms inside to allow the shed to slide right off. And at this point I was getting kind of nervous because the shed didn't look like it was supported at all. But these guys knew exactly what they were doing, and the shed basically stayed horizontal until it got to the very end, and then they just lowered it right to the ground. Now they can attach the wheels to the opposite end of the shed, and they don't need to get in the truck to pull it away. Even that trailer can pull itself hydraulically away from the shed, and now that shed is completely resting on the wheels. Now to get our shed mobile, they need to just insert the Mule under the opposite end and hydraulically lift it up. And the operator doesn't need to stay in the machine anymore, plus he couldn't really see where he was going, and it doesn't need to, because this thing has its own remote control. So at this point, this shed is completely mobile, and he can steer it or move it anywhere he wants. The shed's journey begins to my backyard. Now this was pretty cool watching this, and I've heard about these mules for years, but seeing one in action is really amazing. These guys did a really great job moving this shed. It went around my entire yard, didn't leave any damage, and this really reduces the amount of weight that you're putting on top of a septic or any other kind of soft areas of your yard. And once you get it on top of that gravel surface, you can actually tell these guys to move the building a little to the left or to the right or any position you want because the machine does all the work. Once they get the position right, they spend a couple of minutes to level out the surface and make sure there's nothing interfering with the bottom of the shed. They remove the mule from one end and now they use it to lift up the opposite end so they can take those static wheels off. And with the shed firmly on the ground, they complete the installation by adding the front ramp, and they actually went around and even touched up some of the paint and fixed one of the boards that broke off during the trip. I've bought several sheds over the years, and this is definitely one of the best installations I've ever had. Now, in terms of the price, I paid $8,700 for the shed. Now, that is a lot of money, and if you bought a shed years ago, that sounds like a fortune. But unfortunately, because of COVID and other shortages, lumber prices are through the roof. And I also priced this one against a shed from Home Depot, and that was about $1,500 less, but it didn't have any of the windows, and it definitely didn't look as nice. Soon as the guys were done and took the machinery away, I couldn't wait to check out the shed and see what it looked like. Now you need to remember that no two sheds are alike, even if they're the same size. They can be built using different materials, the quality and structure can be different, so you really want to get details about what's going on inside. And if you're wondering why didn't I build my own shed, it's because I'm not really that good at it. If you watch my channel, you see all kinds of DIY projects, but you'll almost never see any kind of woodworking. And now for the best part, I can actually use the shed. Now, I haven't put up any shelving or hooks yet because I really wanted to just get some of this equipment out of my garage to give me some space to work. But I will be releasing a follow-up video showing how I organize the shed, the products that I use, and also how I finish the area outside the shed. And that'll include loam, grass seed, some landscaping, and even a sandbox for my kids because they still wanted a little bit of stuff to play with when they're outdoors. And the shed's already helping me by storing some of this equipment, and I can't wait to do the organizational stuff so I can store a lot more. And hopefully you found this video helpful. If you did, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel if you're not already for more videos coming up.